I'm going to talk to you a little bit about the other side of BIM. So not so much the technical side, but the policy skills and procurement side of BIM. So there are a number of challenges from this point of view. One, in order to increase the uptake and implementation of integrated environments such as BIM. One of them is, as we've mentioned earlier today, that BIM is an emerging and transformative technology. It changes the way that everything is done, and therefore imposes a challenge to everyone, and requires a new set of skills from the labor force. There is also a lack of performance measurements across the life cycle that can ensure that the benefits are obtained throughout each phase of an asset management, through the each phase of the management of an asset. And then there is also the fact that although we've been hearing about BIM for over a decade and all the great benefits that we're going to get from BIM, which we still hear a lot about, we still need to find that final proof that can create the business case. So to address these challenges, as we've worked in the Integrated Project Environments project last year, it ended a few months ago, and this research basically was around industry and academic expert interviews across Australia and Sweden. And we also carried out a literature and documentation review. And the literature review was worldwide, but we also focused the documentation review in Australia, Sweden, the UK, and the US. And now there is a new project which has started a couple of months ago, which is driving whole of life efficiencies through BIM and procurement. And this research is focusing around three leading national exemplar case studies, which are the new generation rolling stock in Queensland, which is at the design stage at the moment, the Perth Children's Hospital here in Perth, which is in construction stage, and the Sydney Opera House, which is in Sydney and in the asset management stage. To do this research, we're doing also a lot of literature and documentation review, and we are also collaborating with a number of agencies. And yeah.
So I just wanted to reinforce the centre's philosophy around collaboration. So we have core members. Core members are those whose logos you see in between the presentations. And across all of our projects, we also work with about 30 other organisations who are the industry associations. For example, here you see the second one, the Australian Construction Industry Forum, ASIF, is an umbrella organisation, an organisation of organisations representing something like 200,000 members across the industry, the Property Council, Engineers Australia, the architects, quantity surveyors and so on, but also the APCC, Building Smart, Civil Contractors Federation, and in New Zealand, Fletcher, New Zealand Contractors Federation, and NATSPEC in terms of electronic specifications or standardised electronic specifications. So we just wanted to reinforce the on this project and on other projects, we have collaborations well beyond the core membership, and I guess the opportunity to engage at a project level for companies beyond the core partners. Back to Adriana.
And the fact that we've tried to collaborate with a lot of these peak body organisations in Australia and internationally, it's also driven by the fact that if we're talking about a national strategy and increasing the level of skills of the industry and also the procurement across the asset management life cycle, you need to involve all sections of the industry to get something that is actually meaningful for the industry. So from this project, from the project that we just closed, there have been quite a few outcomes. One of them is the Integrated Project Environments booklet, which you would all have gotten when you got in and is being launched later today. So in that booklet, we've addressed three objectives. One of them is around the documentation part of it. So if you are to use BIM, and this project was mostly about transport infrastructure, right? So it was analyzing what the contracts actually need to look at when they're going into BIM in transport infrastructure. Then there was also about if you need to increase the level of skills across the industry, you also need to go to different levels within the supply chain. So there is a little bit of that strategy. Additionally to this kind of information, we've gotten some academic papers out there, and we've also been publishing through Engineers Australia about the importance of BIM and how to achieve higher implementation. We've also created a playlist in our SBNSC channel with just informational videos about BIM. I recommend you to go. There is, for example, a very good one from the Dutch Public Works, which it shows their national strategy and vision for using BIM in transport infrastructure. One of the main outcomes as well was a set of milestones that we believe, based on our research, would achieve an implementation of BIM across the transport infrastructure industry. First of all, we're recommending a national pilot and lessons learned project program. That would lead to evidence-based recommendations. And also, in the background, there needs to be a coordinated effort to create a BIM curriculum, and also to have an agreement around a national strategy. And finally, we also acknowledge the need for industry standards. Within the Driving Whole of Life Efficiency through BIM and Procurement project, this is just started, so there are no real outcomes yet. But we are aiming to have a framework that will help people to sort of identify the benefits they want from BIM and also measure them depending on the project they're in, and to make the case to move from 2D to a fully integrated 3D environment.
So part of the project and part of the charter of our centre is not just engage locally, but to engage internationally. And you've seen both John and Joran present today. What we want to do is to ensure that in Australia we're not reinventing the wheel, to ensure that we get leverage on the investment that Australian firms and state governments are investing in our centre. And so one of the ways that we do this is to engage in the International Council for Research and Innovation in Building and Construction, the CIB. So the CIB is a group of about 5,000 individualies across the globe, and Curtin University with SBE has just recently stepped up its membership to full core member. Our chairman of the board, John McCarthy, is the immediate past global president of this group, and we've got a certain amount of leverage in this organisation that I might say allows Australia to punch above its weight in terms of global influence. We've recently set up a task group 90. 3 weeks ago was the only task group approved in the last board meeting, called Information Integration in Construction. This task group, which allows us to then leverage in other organisations globally, and you'll see some of them there across the Nordic region, across New Zealand, Korea, Hong Kong, and in Brazil, are the initial members of an organisation in a virtual organisation that will look at various aspects of information integration in construction. Some of the issues around technical standards, issues around the mechanisms of transfer of information, but also around some of the issues of communication and skills. Different dimensions will form different components of the task group over the next 3 years, led out of Chalmers University and Curtin University. So encourage those who want to be participants in this group to join in and kick this off as we launch this now over the next 3 years. Thank you. Thank you, Adriana.